Good afternoon. This is afternoon session 2A, pedestrian safety, scrambling elderly district and others. This is somewhat related to this morning's presentation by Paul White and others. This afternoon we have three panelists, Carla Quintello from the pedestrian transportation, and Margaret Chin, Deputy Director of Asian American Authority, and Michael Wao from the 5th Precinct of NYPD. Because of the time restriction, I'll start now to introduce first panelist, Carla Quintello. She's Outreach Director for the Safe Routes for Seniors campaign at Transportation Alternatives, leading local bicycle, pedestrian, and transportation reform group in the United States. Over the last 3 years, her work has raised consciousness of pedestrian safety, safety issues for seniors and people with disabilities in Northern Manhattan and with elected officials. Carla has a degree in urban studies from Barnard College at Columbia University. And in this session, Carla will discuss unique methods for reducing senior pedestrian injuries and fatalities in Chinatown. Carla.
Before I start, I just want to thank my colleague Amy Pfeiffer. We worked together on the senior pedestrian safety issues at Transportation Alternatives, and so I can't take credit for all the wonderful work that we've been doing. We're really a team. And that's Amy, in case you're curious. And also Claire McKnight, because I thought she gave a really wonderful presentation as well. So in my presentation, I just want to build a little bit more on what was mentioned today by Paul Stilly White. He spoke today about the great risks that elderly pedestrians face on Chinatown streets. And so I just want to build on that and talk about what we can do more specifically in Chinatown to actually improve safety and comfort for senior pedestrians through the establishment of what we call an elder district. But before I go into talking, or elaborating rather, on this concept of an elder district, I just want to talk a little bit about why Chinatown is such a good area to focus on for improving pedestrian safety. One of the things that's been mentioned has been the demographics. There is an extremely high concentration of elderly residents in Chinatown. This is a map that shows senior population density by census tract in Lower Manhattan. And if you look at the census tracts in Chinatown, you'll see that pretty much over 20% of the population is 60 plus. The Department for the Aging has said that by 2030, about 23% of the population in New York City will be 60 and over. And so people in New York City are getting older, and especially in Chinatown, as we heard today, this segment of the population is rapidly increasing. And as we know, seniors demand additional level, a higher level of pedestrian safety in order to feel comfortable when walking. Chinatown has extremely high pedestrian volumes. Amy and I went out and we did pedestrian counts on some of the busiest intersections along Canal Street and the Bowery. And just within a 15-minute period at Canal Street and Mott Street, for example, only counting two legs of the intersection, so about half of the intersection, we counted 700 pedestrians. That's really a lot of people, and it's somewhat similar to some of the volumes that you see in Times Square, for example. But and if you wonder why so many people are walking in Chinatown, it's pretty simple. There's a lot of outdoor commercial activity, and that really contributes to a lot of walking. And in addition, as Paul mentioned in his presentation earlier, the streets were laid out in the 18th century, a long time ago, before articulated buses, before trucks, and before cars. They were really made for walking, and they were designed for people, and so people used these streets in that way. In addition, Chinatown has an extremely high volume of senior pedestrians. At these really busy intersections where we counted 700 pedestrians within a 15-minute period, at least 100 of those pedestrians were seniors, if not more. And it's been said over and over again that the senior population in Chinatown is extremely active. They walk everywhere that they need to go. They walk to the senior center, they walk to go shopping, they walk to the park. And this is not necessarily the case in all of New York City, but it's easy to see why. The streets are really small, they're made for people, and so it's really comfortable for seniors to get around in the community. The land uses are really packed in tight in a small area, and so it really lends itself well to this active lifestyle, save some of the larger streets such as Canal and the Bowery and Grand. Chinatown also has an extremely high volume of truck traffic, and it's mainly through truck traffic. If you're a truck driver and you want to get from New Jersey to Brooklyn, or you want to get from New Jersey to the east side of Manhattan, chances are you're probably going to go through Chinatown. You're going to need to access the Manhattan Bridge, and you're going to have to use Canal Street or the Bowery to access the Manhattan Bridge. So this community really does receive a disproportionate amount of through truck traffic. And I think, as Claire mentioned in her presentation, that when trucks are passing through an environment, they're not really paying attention to what's going on. They're just paying attention, focused on where they actually need to go. And this does tremendously impact the level of pedestrian safety for senior citizens. When you have a bunch of trucks that are going through that can't see them and aren't paying attention. Streets are confusing, and pedestrians are confused, as well as drivers. If you look at a lot of the intersections in Chinatown, the geometry is very complicated. The signalization is very complicated. You see this man who's sort of waiting in the middle of what is a very, very large, complicated intersection with high vehicular volumes, and he definitely had enough time to cross the street. He just seems to think that the striping that's on the ground is a dedicated place for him to safely wait, but we all know that that's not necessarily true. And even though both drivers and vehicles are confused, it's a lot more dangerous for a pedestrian that's confused, just because they're a lot more vulnerable in traffic. This is something that is very, very common in Chinatown. You perpetually see crosswalks and sidewalks that are blocked. If you look at some of the busiest intersections along Canal Street and you just observe them for a couple of minutes, you will see that pedestrians have to make a very difficult choice. They either have to wait close to 8 seconds until the crosswalk is clear from all the vehicles that are backed up, or they have to make a decision to weave through dangerous traffic in order to get across the street. That these two women, for example, they have the right of way, but at the same time, they have to compete with all this traffic that isn't really paying attention to them, but is actually just trying to vacate the intersection, because you can imagine there's all this honking going on and all this commotion. And so it really creates a very dangerous situation. Sorry. As we mentioned before, TA did a study, and we found that there were 115 vehicles within a 1 hour period parked illegally on the sidewalk in a 5-square block area in Chinatown. And this is a huge safety issue for senior pedestrians, in particular because the volumes on some of these streets are so high that they can't really compete with other pedestrians that are trying to use the street. If you go on Catherine Street, for example, you'll see a lot of seniors that are in wheelchairs or that have canes that are walking alongside parked cars and moving traffic. And so it's really dangerous. And this is from a Daily News article that was published about the study. And as you see, this man has to walk out into the intersection because there's a parked car that's parked illegally in the crosswalk in front of the curb cut. Safety in numbers. This is something that you see a lot in Chinatown. This intersection is safe when there are 700 people that are crossing it, because the guy that's driving the SUV isn't going to run over 700 people. But what happens when there's only one person trying to get across the street? Here's this man that's trying to get across the street. He has the light, yet he's forced to yield to the vehicle. Chinatown also has a very high rate of senior pedestrian injuries and fatalities. It's probably the highest rate in all of Manhattan. Between the period of 1995 to 2001, 20.7% of all pedestrian injuries and fatalities in Chinatown involved seniors. So there were 232 seniors that were killed or injured in traffic in that period. And in addition, three of the most dangerous intersections for seniors are within this neighborhood. They're Mott and Canal, Canal at the Bowery, and I believe it's Bowery at the Bayard? Or is it Bowery Grand at the Bowery? Why are elderly pedestrians more likely than others to be killed in automobile crashes? These are things that were mentioned earlier. We always cite three reasons. One is because of the sensory changes that happen as people age. If you watch an older person try to get across the street, it really takes them a longer time to figure out what's going on and actually start to cross the street. Two, it's because they're less likely than younger bodies to survive the trauma of a crash. And then three, it's because the streets are too hard for them to cross. And now, a lot of people think that redesigning streets is a very, very complicated and costly process. And that's not necessarily the case. I guess in a little while I'll talk a little bit more about what are some really small and inexpensive modifications that we could make to streets that could make a really big difference. For example, a curb cut was mentioned. Something as basic as a curb cut and as inexpensive as a curb cut really is the difference between someone in a wheelchair being able to get across the street and access a different area of the neighborhood and not. Just about 3 years ago, we started working on a program called Safe Routes for Seniors, and we received funding from the New York State Department of Health to work in Northern Manhattan with seniors to redesign dangerous intersections and corridors to encourage walking. And this was a really great experience. We got to work with seniors and really understand what it means to design streets specifically with the needs of seniors in mind. And one of the things that we learned is that there are four improvements that we could implement right now at very low cost at every intersection and most intersections in the city that would yield tremendous benefits in terms of senior pedestrian safety and significantly reduce the rate of injuries and fatalities among seniors on city streets. And the first one is adjusting the walking time to 2.5 feet per second. Seniors walk at an average rate of 2.5 feet per second, but most lights in the city are timed at a rate of 4 feet per second. And so if we adjust the lights to actually accommodate this walking speed, then it would be a lot more safe, a lot safer and a lot more comfortable for seniors. Fortunately, in Chinatown, the issue isn't really that seniors don't have enough time to get across the street, but rather when it's their turn to cross the street, oftentimes the crosswalk or the curb cuts are blocked by either cars that are backed up in the intersection or illegally parked in front. But something that would work really well in Chinatown is creating what we call a leading pedestrian interval. And that simply means dedicating 5 to 7 seconds at the beginning of the phase so that pedestrians can walk exclusively before turning vehicles get the green light. And this is something I'll explain in more detail in a moment. The third one is just general maintenance, making sure that all streets are clean, that there are no potholes, no cracks, no trip hazards, in the crosswalks, on the sidewalk. And I know a lot of people complained about the conditions of the sidewalk on Canal, but pretty much throughout all of Chinatown, the crosswalks and the sidewalks are in decent condition. And the third is just making sure that every curb cut is installed to the ADA specifications, and furthermore, that every intersection has an adequate curb cut ramp. There are some areas, however, in a neighborhood that either should function differently or that require additional improvements to actually make them safe enough for seniors. And for this, we've developed the concept of an elder district. Just so that you can get a better sense, Mulberry Street at Bayard Street is an area where there's a senior center in a corner, and then there's a park in a different corner, and then there's just a huge amount of seniors that are congregating in this area. And so the way that we treat this intersection in terms of how we design it and how we evaluate its safety should be significantly different from the way that we look at Mott and Canal Street, for example, where there's just a ton of traffic and a lot of tourists and just a different population using the area and different land uses. And so for this, we developed this concept of an elder district. It would be a designation, much like a school zone. You can designate an area in a community, an elder district, in the way that you can designate an area, school zone. And for example, with school zones, an area around a school gets special crosswalks, ladder crosswalks, and signage to indicate that you're entering a school zone. And then once you're in a school zone, drivers are required to reduce their speeds to 15 to 20 miles an hour and also yield to pedestrians. And this reduced speed is achieved either through signage or through the implementation of speed reducers such as speed humps. And so other districts is a little bit more complicated just because it's not everywhere that there's a school, for example. So how would you designate an elder district? Well, anything really can be an elder district. An area where there's a high concentration of senior residents is a good example for an area that would require potentially a higher standard of pedestrian safety. Maybe an area where there's a high rate of senior pedestrian injuries and fatalities. An area where there are land uses that attract a huge amount of seniors, such as senior centers or hospitals or parks. Or even an area that a community gets together and decides that they want to make this area safe for senior citizens and that they want to provide a higher level of pedestrian safety within this area. In our research, when we were doing our field work, we were wondering what would an elder district look like in Chinatown? And so we walked around and we actually followed seniors to see where they went, where they walked, and where they needed additional improvements to actually make them safer. And so this is really a naturally emerging elder district. If you know the area, there's a lot of seniors that live down here at Knickerbocker Village and around the housing complexes that surround Catherine Street. And virtually all of them walk up Catherine Street. They use Catherine Street to access the market. They have to cross East Broadway and Catherine Street. They congregate at Chatham Square where there are benches. And then if they want to go over to the senior center, then they need to cross the Bowery. And then sometimes they walk up Mott Street to get to the senior center, which is on Mulberry and Bayer Pier. And then there's a lot of seniors that also live right here. And this is where Confucius Plaza is. And they have to cross at Bowery and Bayer. They walk along Bayer to get to the senior center or to get to the park. And then also most of the seniors that live right here, they shop along Canal Street where there are a lot of outdoor vendors, fruit vendors and vegetable vendors. So this is our elder district for Chinatown. And in addition to some of the issues and the problems that I mentioned before, we really wanted to focus on protecting pedestrians from fast-turning vehicles. We wanted to also reduce the blockage of the crosswalks and the sidewalks. And we wanted to make sure that they had enough time to cross the street, not having enough time usually being a result of the blocked crosswalks and sidewalks. And also, we wanted to make sure that they had enough safe and comfortable places to wait. So we wanted to look at Catherine Street and Madison Street. Catherine and Madison Street, it happens to be one of the more dangerous intersections in the neighborhood for seniors. And if you go there and you just cross it, you don't really get a good sense of why. But once you stand there for a good 15 minutes, you somewhat start to understand. There's a lot of seniors that live on the other side of Madison Street, so on the southern side, that have to cross to actually get to the market on East Broadway and Catherine, or to do their shopping on Catherine, or even just to other parts of the community. And both these streets really dramatically change in width at this intersection. For example, Catherine Street, the width increases from 23 feet to about 60 feet. And so with this dramatic increase in width comes a lot of speeding. So there are a couple things that we can do to actually reduce speeds and keep seniors safer. And these were most things that were mentioned by Gerard Sophian, Assistant Commissioner of DOT, things that the Department of Transportation has been doing in other parts of the city to keep pedestrians safe. And something very simple that we can actually do to reduce speeds is narrow the street or channelize the traffic. And there are a couple ways that we can do that. One is adding diagonal parking, which is virtually inexpensive. You can just put up signage or put up striping, and it really does use up some of this excess width that is inducing speeding. Something that's a little bit more costly, but also pretty inexpensive, is just adding a little median here at the intersection. It's nice because it creates a safe place for people to wait. It doesn't take care of the excess width after the intersection, but at least it slows people down at the point where people are crossing. Or we could use striping, which is also very inexpensive, just to paint a bicycle lane with a buffer is a good use of the excess width. Or if you don't want to create a bicycle lane and you just want to use striping, drivers usually like striping. They like to be told where they need to go. And so this is also a good way to just remove some of that excess width, which induces speeding. We want to protect pedestrians within our Elder District from fast-turning cars that don't yield to them. In particular, on some of our larger streets, along Canal Street and the Bowery, all of those intersections, you wind up seeing cars not yielding to pedestrians, and also at Catherine and East Broadway, some of our bigger locations. And so some of the things that we can do that are also virtually free, one is installing a leading pedestrian interval so that pedestrians can establish themselves in the intersection before turning vehicles get the green, or before any vehicles can move for that matter. And this is just a video. Let's see if it works. Well, in any case, I guess for whatever reason, it's not working. But this is an intersection at 23rd Street and 6th Avenue where the Department of Transportation has installed a leading pedestrian interval. And if you've been there, you know that you get a good 8 seconds to actually start walking before the vehicles that are coming down 6th Avenue can start turning. And this works really well just because there's such a high volume of turning traffic that if you had been to the intersection before the LPI was installed, you would know that a lot of times the turning traffic tries to compete with the pedestrian traffic and tries to cut them off before they can actually start crossing. And for seniors, having all that time to cross the street is really critical. Something else that Dr. Tam was particularly excited about is something called a pedestrian scramble. This was actually installed in the Chinatown in Oakland in California. It was quite successful there. They did a tremendous amount of outreach, but essentially what it is just separating the pedestrian phase from the vehicle phase, and at the beginning of the pedestrian phase, giving people about 40 seconds to get across the intersection. And you can see it's striped so that people can cross in the traditional way, or they can also cross diagonally. And I think they put up murals in the community. They just did a lot of outreach so that people really understood how the intersection worked. And so there it was pretty successful. It reduced pedestrian and vehicle collisions by about 40%, even though it increased jaywalking and those sorts of things. But it's something that wouldn't necessarily work anywhere, but could work really well somewhere like Catherine and East Broadway, where there's a really high volume of pedestrians and a medium volume of traffic. If you watch people, they are forced to wait there a good 8 seconds when there's no traffic, and you start to see them, since there's such high volumes of pedestrians, they start to cross against the light just because of the safety in numbers thing. And so that would be a good area to potentially pilot something like this. Again, there's the ubiquitous issue of blocked crosswalks and sidewalks. Sidewalks and crosswalks aren't only blocked by illegally parked vehicles, but they're also blocked by articulated buses. The bus stops were placed way before the articulated buses existed, and so what you wind up seeing is the tail end of articulated buses just sticking out into the crosswalk and people having problems, and again, having to walk out into the intersection to get across the street. So one solution for this would be to move the bus stop farther away from the intersection. This is pretty self-explanatory, although now the intersection's probably blocked by those news boxes. Another solution would be to fine or tow illegally parked vehicles. And we're very happy, we've been working with the community to do advocacy around this illegal parking issue, in particular sidewalk parking by municipal employees, just because of the pedestrian safety implications. And we're happy to note that Mayor Bloomberg and the 5th Precinct have been doing a lot lately to actually crack down on this issue. Another solution would be to install bollards along the sidewalk. Bollards are very inexpensive. They come in very many different shapes and sizes and forms. They cost about $300 each. But you can install them along the sidewalk, and in addition to actually preventing cars from jumping onto the curb, which you know happens because people are parking on the sidewalk, it also keeps pedestrians safe.
That's a good idea. Let's do that.
And And then, of course, installing a leading pedestrian interval is also a good solution for unblocking the crosswalks in particular, just because even though the crosswalk might be blocked for this initial 8 seconds, it gives the vehicles an additional 8 seconds of clearance to actually get out of the crosswalk, and so then at least people have the allotted amount of time that they're given by the signal already to get across the street. Removing a parking spot closest to the curb by extending the curb. This is something that was also mentioned before. This would work really well on some of our larger streets like Canal Street and the Bowery, where there's already a really high volume of pedestrians that are congregating at the corners and waiting to cross the street. And so it would really provide a little bit of extra space to actually wait. It provides more visibility, better view of oncoming traffic. Traffic can actually see the pedestrians a little bit better, which is really important as well. But even safer would be something like this, where the curbs are extended, but then there's also bollards that are added, just so that cars, when they're turning, don't jump up onto the curb. And if they do, they wind up hitting a bollard instead of the person. And then finally, there's the issue of not having enough safe places to wait. So what can we do for our friend that's calmly waiting in the middle of a very, very dangerous intersection? Well, very simple. We can take these stripe medians. They exist all along the Bowery, for example, and we can raise them. We can add median tips and then add bollards. And this is a different form of bollard. It's in a bell shape. But this is also something that's very inexpensive, in particular because the design is already there. But it costs about $10,000 to add the median, maybe about $1,000 to add a median tip, and then the bollards I already mentioned. But this is really good. It provides a safe place for people to wait, and in addition, it protects them from the vehicles that are turning because of the bollards. And this is just a better picture. So just to summarize this whole elder district designation, we would have specific areas within a neighborhood that would receive additional pedestrian improvements so that they could have a higher level of pedestrian safety. And there are additional improvements to the ones that I mentioned today, but just to summarize, adjusting the walking time to 2.5 feet per second, which is not an issue in Chinatown so much. Dedicating exclusive crossing time for pedestrians before vehicles can actually turn, so installing these LPIs, leading pedestrian intervals. Making sure that streets are clean, with no potholes, with no cracks, with no trip hazards, is critical for seniors. Making sure that curb cuts installed are compliant with the ADA standards. Zero tolerance of illegal parking. Sidewalk parking, parking in front of the curbs, parking at the crosswalk is very, very dangerous for seniors. It forces them out onto the street. Installing audible, accessible pedestrian signals at all crossing. And these are the signals that you can actually put your hand on and then they chirp or they vibrate, indicating what direction you can cross. And if you have a really high population of seniors or people with vision impairments, this is very good. Also, where street widths exceed 60 feet, installing steel bollards at the double yellow line. This prevents drivers from making really wide turns and protects pedestrians in case they're caught in the middle of the street. And also, where street widths exceed 90 feet, install pedestrian refuges in the form of medians, median tips, and bollards. So creating safe places for people to wait on these really large streets that they have difficulty getting across. And then finally, this is something that's done in the school zones, limiting speeds to 20 miles per hour. The faster a car is going, the more likely it is that a senior is going to be killed if he or she is struck. And so reducing these speeds is really critical to keeping them safe. And this can be done in a number of different ways, but the ways that we prefer are by installing vertical deflectors or traffic calming devices. And these are maybe, but aren't limited to, speed humps or speed tables, raised intersections or crosswalk, which simply just means raising the pavement a couple of inches, curb extensions or bus bulbs with bollards. Curb extensions and bus bulbs are the same thing. And with bollards, they're even safer. Adding bicycle lanes to narrow the street so that traffic moves a little bit slower, mini roundabouts, and diagonal parking. So this is a senior that we encountered when we were doing our field work. And this is sort of, in addition to all the active seniors that I encountered in the community, she's sort of an inspiration for me to keep working on improving senior pedestrian safety in Chinatown. I want to be able to make sure that she can make it to the park every single day so that she can get her physical activity. And so, just to conclude, aside from that, I want to thank the 5th Precinct. I know there's a representative from here, from the 5th Precinct today, for all the work that they've been doing to actually improve pedestrian safety by towing cars that are illegally parked on the sidewalk. It's a huge benefit. And also thank Mayor Bloomberg. But as Paul mentioned, I just want to give another little plug. We have these postcards. We want to thank Mayor Bloomberg, but also urge him to do a little bit more. And it start installing some of these curb extensions and bollards and start changing some of the signal timing, adding these leading pedestrian intervals to really protect senior pedestrians on some of the large streets where they have most trouble. So if it takes about 2 minutes, if you can just get one and fill one out and send it out, really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Carla. It was very interesting talk. I was in a hurry to start the session and I didn't introduce myself properly. My name is Humabur Karen and Professor of Chemistry, currently Executive Director of Special Research and Special Initiatives at Medvedev's College, CUNY. Actually, I was talking to Professor McKnight that London or in Japan, Tokyo, the crowded city, they already have some solution like a color indicated, making narrower streets for the cars, more wide, you know, sidewalk for pedestrians, and all the square area that people can cross the intersection, diagonally type of things. So I'm glad to hear some of the, you know, ideas coming into the crowded city like New York. I will ask each presenter to present first, and then I'll open to the audience to interact with the panelists. Next speaker is Margaret Chin. Margaret is the Deputy Executive Director of Asian American for Equality. She has over 25 years of experience working in the Asian community in the field of education, housing, advocacy, and accessing equal opportunity for all people of color. Ms. Chin served on the U.S. Census Bureau Race and Ethnic Advisory Committee on Asian and the Pacific Islander Population for Census 2000. She's currently a board member of the New York Immigration Coalition and the Asian Alumni Group of City College of New York. I think it's a lot of city college connections. Margaret will kind of respond to Carlos' presentation and present aspects from the community. Margaret.
Thank you. I'm really looking forward to have some, you know, discussion with what Carla presented, and also this whole, you know, elder district concept. Some of the remarks that I wanted to make was, you know, my personal experience working in Chinatown and how some of the difficulties of pedestrians trying to cross the street. I think what's good for the senior is going to be what's good for us also. And you see, you know, mother with baby carriage, and, you know, even you're crossing the street, you try to carry your grocery and you try to, you know, make the light, and it is quite difficult. One of the main point that I really want to get at for our communities, especially for seniors, is that we really have to do a massive education campaign on, you know, pedestrian safety, how to cross, and also how to advocate for their rights so that they could be safe in their own community. Because of those seniors, we work with a lot of them on a day-to-day basis, and a lot of time, you know, we bring them down to City Hall, and, you know, to rally and to testify, and some of the seniors, they don't follow the lights, okay? They jaywalk. And I have specifically one person, he's over 80 years old, and he's always running across the street and not following the street light. And we just like are so mad at him that he doesn't, you know, treat safety. But he's kind of cute in a way, because he said he still could run across the street. But I think a lot of the area in Chinatown that was highlighted in Carl's presentation, it is so true that every day it is a challenge just to navigate those streets. And I don't want to do, you know, like to go back to all the point that you raised. I just want to raise a couple of issues that when we were doing the Rebuild Chinatown initiative and we looked at East Broadway, and it's such a long block, one of the suggestions that we made was to do mid-block crossing. that might, you know, this way prevent people from jaywalking and also provide another safe way of people to cross from one side to the other. The concept you raised about the cars, every time they turn, that is really a dangerous situation for seniors and for all of us. Because when they turn, they don't care if you're crossing, they just come right at you. And the concept that you had, like, pedestrian first, the city don't really have that. I know that one of the cross section on Canal and Center, they allow the car to turn first. And sometimes people don't realize that, and they start crossing because the other car on the other side of the street stops. So you assume you can cross, and meanwhile these cars are coming at you. The other intersection that come in mind is near our office on Pike and East Broadway. And that is a huge, you know, street, so that when buses turn and tour bus, and that's where there was one fatality recently, right in front of our office. And that's the area where also a lot of the seniors were having a problem crossing, because the street is so wide, and you really have to figure a way of finding a way that people can cross safely with all these cars turning. And to go back to the point about the mid-block crossing, and some of the area that you talked about was that it's such a high volume of pedestrians, so why couldn't we really look at maybe some of those streets, whether like Bowery and Canal, whether we can do a mid-block crossing there instead of crossing at the corner of Bowery and Canal where the truck traffic is coming down from the bridge and they're turning down Bowery, so we can also look at that. Lastly, the point I want to make is also the evening part. That Canal Street is very dark at night. All the intersection along, you know, Canal, whether you cross at Mon or Mulberry or Elizabeth, is very dark. Some of the street lights are not there. There's only traffic light. So at night, I mean, a lot of seniors, they the group that performed tonight, I mean, this afternoon, they go to a lot of parties at night. And they have to cross that street, you know, going home, you know, because like a restaurant is like Harmony Palace on 98 Mon is on the north side of Canal. But going home at night is very difficult for people to cross. So I think that's another observation. But I think that we really are looking forward to working with Transportation Alternative to really try to help create this elder, you know, zone so that our seniors will be protected. And we are also, I'm also on the board of the Chinatown Partnership Local Development Corporation, and we are looking at traffic patterns and traffic issues so that we can work together to really make it more pedestrian friendly in our community and provide more safety. I think that would be a great impact. And community education will be a very key component. Thank you.
Thank you, Mara, for your comments and response. The third panelist is Michael Lau. He grew up in Chinatown, and he has served for police force about 20 years, and he is the deputy inspector at NYPD. And since January 2006, he serves as a commanding officer at the 5th Precinct of NYPD. And prior to the current position, he was in the Department of Community Affairs at the NYPD headquarters for 3 years. Apparently, at that time, he had a lot of statistics and information about the Asian communities and also traffic issues. So without further ado, Michael.
I think I'm going to be as prepared as the other speakers because basically I tried not to come here today, honestly. And since January, I've been commanding also the 5th Precinct. And what's funny is that some of these things that we're talking about today, I was a cop there in 1987 to 94. So some of these topics that we're talking about, I guess I experienced them 18, 19 years ago. My parents are actually two of those seniors that you're talking about doing that route. They take a slightly different route. They don't like Catherine and Madison there because projects on one side, the bus stop is right at the corner. They actually don't like that. They like East Broadway a little better. But I'll just start by giving a little couple of stats. Year to date, so this is as of, I guess, Monday, we're actually down 1% in total accidents, and for pedestrian accidents, we're down about 6%. And year to date, when we break it down, in regards to pedestrian accidents, whites make up about 27%, blacks 5%, Asians 55%, and Hispanics 12% of the pedestrians that were injured. And when we look at that a little further, out of these, when we talk about Asians, out of these, I guess, let's see, 13 plus 31 Asians that were injured crossing the street, pedestrians, six were in their 60s or 70s, so that's about 19%. When we talk about everybody all together, it's about 11% for seniors. We had one fatality so far this year, but it involved a bicyclist that was actually cutting in between. I heard a couple mentions about crossing mid-street. I guess unless we have a lot of controls in place, I would rather not do that. That's what this bicyclist was doing, and he ran into a tractor trailer and ran in between the cab and the trailer park. Another thing I heard mentioned by Margaret was education. I was actually born in Hong Kong, so I remember years ago when I went back to Hong Kong, most of the major streets actually had railings where you couldn't cross, except at the intersections. In fact, I remember seeing these like neon signs, public service announcement type things, and it showed basically a pedestrian crossing midway and getting splattered by a car. So that, even though that was in 1990, that left an imprint in my mind. One of the things our department really looks into, so what we actually looked at, and this is when I was, before I even came to the fifth precinct. We looked at the changing demographics, and I want everyone here to know that the police department, we really put a lot of effort into studying, you know, the community. So, for example, from this chart, from the census numbers, and I know it's a little updated now, it's 2006, we looked at the people coming in, and it's broken down into different groups, and we looked at, the changes, just hit it. I'm not technically savvy, so I'm sorry. So we looked at the changing demographics and the Asian population in general. Because one of the things we saw was that we saw just from the news articles that there were, people getting struck by autos, and so we looked at that. And this is the chart that we, incorporated from the census numbers and also from the Department of Aging, and it shows that Manhattan, it's up there in regards to the Asian population, but also Queens led. My last command before going to headquarters was actually the 109 precinct, which probably had the highest concentration of Asians. Now I'm just going to skip. This is actually part of a presentation for seniors, but we encompass everything, safety. And one part of it is not only home safety, not how not to be a victim of a crime, but also traffic. And so we talk about these charts, and this presentation is actually also given in Chinese. In community fairs while we were there, we actually have this also in English and Chinese. But since I was not a good student in Chinese school, I can only do it in English. But when we used to do it, we also had translators if I needed to do it, or we had a Chinese-speaking reading officer actually do this presentation in Chinese. So we talked about, in regards to education, the highest number of fatalities, the over 65 group, and when we talked about tips, and this is something the police department actively does, crossing only on sidewalks, watching for cars turning, and this is something I try to get my own parents to do, Like my parents assumed that once they step off the curb, the whole world stops for them, including all cars, and everybody sees them. And we explained that people don't see you. You might think that they see you, but they don't. And one of the techniques we teach is, try to get that eye contact when you're in an intersection. And I always tell my parents, try to wear bright colored clothing so it's even more visible, especially if you're going out later in the evening. We teach never crossing against the light, and again, never assuming that they see you. And one of the things you talked about was that as we get older, our reflexes are slower, so that, when you're, not my age, I'm old, but when you're younger, you're a teenager, you can jump, you can skip, but when you're older, you have less time to react. So. And then this is actually other parts of what we talk about, seniors, all the other different things. But we also have these brochures, and it's in Chinese. We actually, the police department, when we looked at the changing immigration numbers, we translated these brochures into different languages. Spanish, Chinese, French, Urdu, and Russian. So these are five languages that many of our department brochures are translated into. You showed an article, Daily News, before. I think they had a follow-up article. I'm not sure, it might be even today. But I think it talked about some of the improvements, and it's not coming from me so much, but I think community members were saying that they've seen a recently improvement in the situation in Chinatown. We look at this as almost like a crime type of deal. We looked at what the problem was, which was congestion. You mentioned black sidewalks, people have to walk around vehicles. You didn't mention, but I'll mention it, safety hazards. These vehicles, same vehicles, blocking fire hydrants, bus stops, which causes somewhat dangerous conditions. As the, I guess relatively new, I've been there since January, commanding officer of the precinct, what we started doing was, first we looked at who the violators were, and when we looked at it, it turns out it was multi-agencies. It wasn't just the police, it wasn't just law enforcement, it was other city agencies, it was a whole bunch of people. So our first step was to actually bring in these different agencies and actually speak to the highest representative that we could, and the meetings were held at the 5th Precinct. So we talked to representatives from court division, corrections, the FBI, sanitation, federal security, homeland security, the federal protective services. We brought in all these different agencies and we had a series of meetings. Of course, not everybody attended every meeting, but we made sure that a high-ranking representative from each of these agencies attended these meetings. Following the meetings, we actually basically agreed upon that, especially the safety violations, the hydrants, the crosswalks, the bus stops, couldn't be tolerated. And as the CEO of the 5th Precinct, what I would start doing was that on the strong safety violations, I would actually summons vehicles, regardless of whether they were civil servants or not. Now, again, I don't want to say that this was only a problem caused by government and government agencies. We had also complaints, for example, a private security company was using Mott Street as a garage for all the vehicles. Every day on a daily basis, they would park 5-6 vans on the block and just leave it there for 8-9 hours. So it wasn't just city agencies. We also met with private companies, and we instructed them that if they were not to stop that practice, that we would take a strong enforcement action. Following the initial meetings, we started putting warning notices on vehicles. Following the warning notices, we started contacting those agencies and speaking to their representatives. And following that, we started giving summonses. And following that, I started towing. So somebody had mentioned at the other meeting today that they walked down Mott Street and they saw like 5 vehicles improperly parked. Now, I spent about 12 hours yesterday in the precinct, and I went down Mott Street and Bear Street several times, and if I saw 5 vehicles the whole day, maybe that would be correct, but for example, I came in today at 9 o'clock, and Bayard Street and Mott Street was totally clear. I don't think that I saw any improper vehicle other than trucks making deliveries at the time I saw them. So I think, I don't think we're going to solve all these problems overnight, but I think it's a work in progress, and I think we're making strides to improving the situation. And I think the community has been very supportive. I think they let me know very vocally when I make a mistake, or when they think I make a mistake, or when there's issues. And I think as a member of police department, and even all these other city agencies that we met with and federal agencies, everybody was very concerned and took very quick action when we expressed these community concerns. So, thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Even if you didn't want to come, I'm really glad you came and to hear from
the public speaker.
Police station's aspect. Now, I think it's about 10, 15 minutes. I know we're a little behind, but we'd like to have some questions or interactions. Yes, Ed?
Yes, I'd like to address to Carla. You mentioned about, Michael mentioned about this medicine and Catherine Street. That section, I think I'm an expert. The reason why, because my wife always wants to do some shopping there, and my car parked on the side, the fire hydrant on the side. I watched the car just a few minutes. You know what? Because the Catherine Street, you can go there to South Street, to Roosevelt, FDR. So that the only way to get there, so all car cluster to that street from, because there's on the south is Brooklyn Bridge, on the other side is the Market Street, so northbound one way. So that's the only way, that's why the car was dashing through the Catherine to FDR. So I think that some kind of traffic limit or some kind of signage and would be reduced, because that's why I think the elderly is very intimidating, you know, every car very dashy through or through that way. That's the only traffic in that area, that's the only outline to quick way to highway. I think that's the problem, that's the density, high density of a low, you know, class, working class, and they are almost similar. This is the neighborhood. Why do they rush?
Any response?
Yeah, that echoes something that Claire said. It's just trying to reduce this traffic that's going through an area without any kind of sensitivity for the environment. There's a lot of seniors that are living here, and you can't just speed through the intersection just because it sort of comes into conflict with the way that, with their needs in terms of pedestrian safety and how they use an area. And so it's, yeah, you make a very valid point, and that's sort of why we're working towards establishing this elder district legislation.
I have a question.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a little bit police related, although I know traffic police is a separate unit from the local precinct, but I was wondering the police role in avoiding or preventing the traffic accident, because especially in Canal Street, you know, they are, because it's such a high volume traffic major transport area, so there are always a lot of traffic police during the rush hours and even in non-rush hours, and their priority is simply directing the traffic. They don't care about traffic, they don't care about the lighting, they don't care about pedestrians. Their priority is to make sure the cars goes through. And I wonder if you, either from research point of view or from the police point of view, have you noticed that whether if they're actually preventing or sort of enhancing the accident.
Boy, you mentioned Canal Street. That's actually the most, we actually categorize the locations as for traffic accidents. So the Canal Street corridor, the whole length of Canal Street, confines of the fifth precinct, is the highest number of accidents that we have, which is 9 for the year so far. But we look at these locations, and what we do is try to address it through a variety of things, through signage, through enforcement, which is through summonses, and And that's what we try to do. We look at the top location facts and at the intersections, and we look at what the concerns are. For example, Bowery and Kenmare, we put in a request through DOT to put in a don't block the grid because of vehicles turning. And blocking the intersection causes people to be impatient, try to attempt to cross anyway. So we look at different factors and different tools as a method to try to reduce accidents.
I think what he's talking about is really having the traffic enforcement personnel standing at the intersection of Canal and let's say Lafayette or Broadway. Are they creating hazard? Because their concern is not the pedestrian, their concern is moving the vehicles. Go ahead, move. Even though the pedestrian has a green light to cross the street, they don't get to cross the street. So I think that's what he's talking about, and I'm concerned about that too, because I do see that. I'm standing street corner, I'm like, excuse me, I have to walk that. No, you have to wait. The cars are going.
Right.
That's a real problem.
Right. I understand what he said, but I don't think the accident is happening while they're directing traffic, because when you have somebody actually physically standing there, you're stopping. You might not be happy that you have to stop, but you're stopping, so it's not causing the accident.
But as far as the education is concerned, if we tell the pedestrian, if we tell the senior citizen, you know, when it's green light or whatever, you know, then you have somebody tell them, no, you can't go yet, even though you have the light. That kind of like, you know, that, what does it say about our education? How are we going to educate them?
We always wonder whether it's questionable. You have some of these really dangerous intersections, and then the way that you make them safer is you stick someone in a really dangerous situation. I mean, that's not even safe for the traffic cop. It's somewhat a little bit backwards. But yeah, I just moved to the area and I was crossing Pearl Street, and I get to the middle of the intersection, and then I have to wait in this really dangerous situation. I can't go back, I can't go forward. It's a big problem.
Well, I just think that the environment is really for cars and not for pedestrians.
Right.
So if there are areas that we can have some control over, like when Carl was talking about, within our own community, we could create some kind of zone, you know, where the seniors and the visitors can feel safe. We should try to do those things. Because otherwise, right now Chinatown is situated at a very busy section, you know, Canal Street. If there's some way we could slow the traffic down in Canal Street, we should find some way of doing it, because that's how people rush from the bridge to the tunnel, and it's chaotic in a lot of times. Like, it's very difficult for people to cross. And the sidewalk, you know, the pictures that you show, so there's garbage cans there, there's news, you know, those machines there, and it's very dangerous for people to cross. I mean, for us, we would want to see if there's way of even closing off some of the streets during the day or weekend to just pedestrians.
Like the Fulton Wall. Yeah, that would be very nice.
But at least try it out on weekend. I mean, there's Little Italy has, you know, Mulberry Street, they do that in Chinatown. That would be really good, not just for the senior, but for everybody that visits the community.
We actually submitted a proposal also to the DOT to make Canal Street available for metered parking after the rush hour. That would definitely slow things down on Canal Street. The same thing was done on Queens Boulevard. There was some opposition in the beginning, but now it seems to have reduced the number of accidents. So that's another proposal that the precinct submitted for Canal Street.
Any other?
Yes.
Just a question.
Our question is specifically about Canal and Mott, which, as I recollect, is the highest number of accidents on the crash map. When I was walking down Canal, I was anxious to get there to see what was happening. When I got there, it didn't look bad. I'm curious whether anybody at the table or anywhere in the audience could illuminate me as to why that's the worst intersection. What is wrong there? Is it just a matter of volume?
It's volume. It's also cars trying to make that left turn into mine. There's no real turning signal. So you might have to make that turn when it's actually red on your side when you're going westbound.
There's also a lot of seniors crossing in that area that are going shopping. That's just where they cross, because they're coming up Mott Street. But I'm not sure. It definitely is the turning vehicles that are turning onto Mott, for sure. It's really causing a lot of problems. Mott Street, the environment there is just completely different from Canal.
So does it help if you have a sign, arrow for to turn? Does it help? Or?
In some areas it's helpful, like separating, definitely separating the turns from the pedestrians and reducing that conflict is always helpful.
And I think that they have the loop stand right there on the sidewalk, so that reduces the amount of sidewalk space for the pedestrian.
Yeah, operate, you know, more than one year ago, Car Society talked about we have to review the Chinatown initiative and the insurance, college insurance. I mentioned 3 points. Hollywood, I think LDC, Hollywood there, that time, you know, post-universe limit, 25 or 30 miles. And I put the bumps on the street, the barrier. And the third, I took the word of your words, the lighting, you know. Assuming that I'm on the task force of CATS, CETS, Canal Area Transportation Studies, I talked 3-4 times. Nobody changed, nobody responds. So I expect you, Carlo and Margaret to talk to them again. The light, the bumps, and the traffic sign, limit signs.
Every positive has sometimes some negative. When you install the bumps, it creates a lot of noise.
Yeah, I know.
So, especially the Bowery, there's certain areas in China that are changing drastically. We have million-dollar condos, and I mean, that's the other downside of it. When you create these obstacles, artificial obstacles, that causes, and you're still going to have that truck traffic. You know, every time a truck hits a bump, it creates a lot of noise.
But definitely the lighting part, we're working on it. I mean, one of the things that with the Chinatown Partnership Local Development Corporation, we are looking at this issue, and the parking on Canal Street definitely will help, you know, once we have that, because we want it really to light it up at night. So the people coming into Chinatown, that come through the subway, they utilize the community, will feel safer and also will be more attractive. And of course the lighting, you know, if you want to add extra light, it costs money. And then also Con Ed and DOT, they want to make sure there's an entity, an organization who's going to be responsible, you know, liability and all that stuff. So, but we are working on it, and that it will be a critical issue. So along with the parking on Canal, that's a step forward.
Well, looks like the next session is going to start. So I'd like to thank you, Carla and Margaret and Michael, despite of their very busy schedule, they came to be a panelist. So thank you, and please give them a